Our next speaker has a resume that most of us only can dream of. A three-time world champion skier, a two-time Olympian, an all-American college football player who was later drafted by the Philadelphia Eagles. And by the way, he is now CEO of a marketing tech company that has just raised $70 million in venture capital. No big deal. Jeremy Bloom will join us on stage here to talk about how his experiences in sports have translated to his success in being CEO of Integrate. Please help me welcome Jeremy Bloom. Whatever it takes, 'cause I love the adrenaline in my
veins. I do whatever it takes. I feel like I'm Michael Jackson or Madonna up here, but great to be here. G2 is a great partner for us at Integrate, and I'm just delighted to be here with all of you on the first inaugural G2 event. So I want to share a little bit about my story, and I'll get back to the G2 piece in a little bit. But I grew up in Colorado with two completely different parents. My dad, huge sports fan, huge Olympics fan, huge NFL fan, Denver Broncos. Sorry for the Bears fans here. But I idolized John Elway growing up. And my dad is a hard charger, a little bit less now, he's in his 70s, but he was back then. And the most important thing was winning. Like whatever we were gonna do, we were gonna do to win it. My mom was a little bit of the opposite. She liked sports, didn't love the physicality of football, tried everything to try to get me not to play football, including, this is a true story, I just remembered. Maybe she didn't pay my pediatrician, but she definitely lobbied to, like, he pulled out the chart when I was 14 and said, here's the kids that play football. It's like the height and weight. And they're like, here's you way down here. Like, you're super small and you're underweight. So maybe football's not for you. And I was like, yeah, right, doc. I'll show you. She always really kind of focused myself, my brother, and my sister on education. On anytime I would bring John Elway up, she'd be like, yeah, but look what he does off the field. Look how he gives back and all these things. So my dad used to do interviews with us every year on our birthday, and he would ask us a bunch of questions. And when I was 10 years old, he asked me what I wanted to do with my life.
Any idea what you want to be when you grow up, or not sure yet?
I want to try to go to the Olympics and win a gold medal in skiing. But I have to get my college degree first, and I have to major in something. So there's a backup plan, and if I don't do anything in the Olympics, I can go to that plan.
Good.
So you can see the balance between the two, my mom and my dad. My dad was my first football coach. He was my ski coach. He was there every step of the way with me in my athletic career. And he really loved the Olympics. And every year that the Olympics were on, we'd sit down, we'd watch them together. And anytime a U.S. athlete would win an Olympic gold medal, I'd look over and he'd be like wiping the tears away from his eyes. I mean, that's how much he loved sport. He loved Olympics. He loved the national anthem, playing all these things. And that permeated me as a young child. And I think it helped drive some of my goals and focus to win an Olympic gold medal. I also had the dream to play in the NFL. So when I was about 11, I told my mom and dad I want to ski in the Olympics and play in the NFL. And 13 years after this video,
it is nighttime here. Jeremy Bloom, college football star and world champion freestyle skier. Next February, this winter warrior brings a gridiron mentality to the Olympic slopes. Jeremy twists around moguls like they were 300 pounds of angry linebacker on a ski run to daylight for the ultimate goal, Olympic immortality. The Olympics coming February to the networks of NBC. Jeremy Bloom, one tough hombre.
So this was leading into my second Olympics. My first Olympics, I was 19 years old. It was in Salt Lake City. I came into those games, the number one ranked skier in the world, and it was really my first experience on the national stage. And the spotlight was so incredibly bright, it was too bright for me to understand how to navigate through it. I had yet to develop the mental ability to be able to deal with that type of pressure. And I didn't accomplish my goal of winning a gold medal in Salt Lake City. This video was taken right before the 2006 Torino Olympics. And the year before, I had already played 2 years of college football against Florida State, against Oklahoma, you know, so I was able to develop the ability to handle a national stage, to handle that type of pressure. I was 23 years old and not 19. And the year before those games, I won more consecutive World Cups than anybody had in history. And going into those games, I had the mental and physical ability that I knew that I needed to have in order to accomplish my goal of winning that. And it was in Torino, Italy. It was at night, under the lights. My mom was in the grandstand below. My dad was watching on a live feed back home because he was too nervous to travel to the Olympics. And I remember sliding into the gate and kind of this replay played in my mind of all the training and all the hours spent and all the dedication. I literally spent most of my 20 years for 22 seconds. Freestyle skiing is 22 seconds. You have 22 seconds to have a perfect run and accomplish your goals. Here's my final run in the Olympics.
It is nighttime here at the Olympic Winter Games. It's the Men's Moguls Olympic Gold Medal Final, and this is Jeremy Bloom. World Cup victories, 5 in a row last year, 6 if you include the dual moguls competition. He had a silver at the World Championships in 2003. He's a two-sport athlete. But right now, Trace, there's only one thing left for him to do, and that is go for Olympic gold.
He has 22 seconds to earn Olympic gold. He told us his dream is to win Olympic gold and then win a Super Bowl ring following that. See if he can get the first of two right now. We spoke to his mother, Shar, earlier today. She told us that Jeremy does not have football on his mind at all right now. She said he's 1,000% Olympics and going for gold. 720 on the top, crossed up. Bloom has seen everybody else go down. He knows what it takes. He gets a little bit back right there on the top. We'll see if he can make up for that mistake. Small mistake at the top. Great D-spin on the bottom. And Bloom comes through the finish. Not the best run I've ever seen out of Jeremy Bloom. 22.79 seconds. Tight and clean, but a small bobble on the top air as he entered the middle section of this course that's 740 feet long.
We saw him have trouble in virtually the same place this morning at qualifiers.
An explosive top air, a 720 crossed up. Look at the air on that. Lands on the 27-degree slope, but here's what all goes wrong. He doesn't maintain good rhythm. He gets thrown in the back seat, and with this elite field, it doesn't take but a small mistake to knock you out of medal contention. Gets it back together because Bloom has so much strength, but the judges will catch that mistake at the top. You can pretty much pack your bags. Pretty big impact on that bottom air. Again, not the best overall run from Bloom.
And here are the scores, and he knew it. There will be no medals of any color for Jeremy Bloom.
And Steve, for all intents and purposes, that was the last competitive mogul run we'll see out of Jeremy Bloom. An incredible career.
1 inch. One inch was the difference. Just that little break in the knees was the difference between sixth and first. And as I exited that gate, I did the media thing, kept it together. My mom was waiting for me. She gave me a great big hug. And she said, "I'm so proud of you," which I replied to, "What the fuck are you proud of? I just lost the Olympics." But moms are amazing because she's been there every step of the way, including the times where I was on top and the times when I wasn't. But once I went to my hotel room in Torino, that's really where I kind of lost it. For me, and I do keep this in perspective, I understand these are first world problems, but for me, that was rock bottom. Because I knew when I woke up the next day, that one thing I always wanted was no longer going to be there. And I had to figure out how to deal with this at 23. And it was somewhere in that night, through the avalanche of thoughts that were going through my head, that I made myself a promise. And I said, I'm going to take 48 hours. I'm going to take 48 hours and I'm going to reflect on everything I possibly can, figure out what lesson lives inside this moment. And I'm going to distill it down and I'm going to take that with me and then I'm going to move on 1,000 miles per hour. And the common thread that unites all of us is we've all been there, one way or another. Maybe not at the Olympics, but in life, no matter who you are, we will inevitably meet a setback. Steve Jobs was fired from Apple, right? The company he started. He didn't have to go start Pixar and Next, but he did. Michael Jordan cut twice in high school. How many high school basketball players today would continue playing basketball if they got cut twice? Walt Disney, we all know the story, right? Fired for a, quote, lack of imagination at his first publishing job. So literally all of us go through this. And that fact was not lost upon me. So I woke up the next day, and I boarded a flight to Indianapolis for the NFL Combine, which is where college football players get their first opportunity to meet with the NFL. You run a 40-yard dash, you meet with coaches in the NFL. It's really your first point of exposure into the National Football League. So within a week, I was skiing in the finals of the Olympics and running a 40-yard dash at the NFL. It was a pretty cool week. I'm not asking you to feel bad for me, but it was awesome, and I was living kind of two really big dreams. And then about a month later, it's the NFL draft, and NFL Films was following my journey from the Olympics to the NFL. And I got a phone call from an area code that I didn't recognize, and it was the Philadelphia Eagles.
Hey, Eagles, how you doing, man?
Good, man, how are you?
Hey, you there?
Yeah.
Hey, our gentleman would like to talk to you, all right?
Okay.
Okay, hang on. Hey, Jeremy, how you doing?
Doing real well, how are you?
All right, doing good. Hey, you want to be an Eagle?
You know I do.
All right, man, you can get some big time victory for us and play a little receiver.
Oh, I'd love to, man.
All right, well, we're going to take you right here.
Oh, man, thank you so much.
All right, man, we look forward to it. All right, coach, you want to talk to?
All right.
Okay. How you doing?
Hey, Coach Reed.
How are you?
Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Yeah, no, absolutely. You did a nice job for us, man.
I can't wait.
Family excited?
I'm so excited.
Good.
Thank you so much.
All right, man. I'm going to pass the phone on here to Jason Light.
Okay.
Can you believe this?
Oh, man. Go to your hometown, pal.
I cannot believe it.
Oh, my God. Wow.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Oh my God. I'm so happy.
You're so proud. You gonna come to Philly?
All the time.
I was really hoping to go to Denver Broncos again. Screw that.
Oh man.
Isn't that weird?
I can't believe it.
My dad grew up in Philly.
I cannot believe it.
The Eagles.
Oh my God.
I'm telling you, he's always crying, that guy. Like, you know, like he's hilarious, like on cue. I had an amazing time, you know, living inside the walls of the National Football League, playing for Andy Reid for the Philadelphia Eagles, who's now the head coach at Kansas City. And getting to play with guys like Donovan McNabb and Brian Dawkins and Brian Westbrook. And it was just like a daily experience of pinching yourself, like, should I ask for their autograph? No, I probably shouldn't. Like, I really want to. And learning kind of what I would describe as the most competitive environment, team, corporate, whatever, known to humankind is the NFL. I can't think of one that's more competitive. And then I got an amazing opportunity to spend a season, an amazing season with the Pittsburgh Steelers. Couple fans here. they didn't look so good against the Patriots, but and to be coached by Mike Tomlin, who today is still the best leader I've ever been around. He can unite a group of people that come from a lot of different backgrounds in a way that is truly unique. And I got to play with Troy Polamalu and Hines Ward and Ben Roethlisberger, and it was really there what I learned, that I learned what a connected culture can do. Because in 2008, they weren't the most talented football team on paper. It wasn't even close. They weren't picked to win the Super Bowl. But what was palatable inside that locker room was how connected their culture was, and how locked arms their culture was. But the NFL actually had a bigger impact on my life off the football field. There's an incredible program for NFL players where you can take MBA classes at Kellogg, Harvard, Stanford, or Wharton for free. They pay for it. And so I was like, sign me up for that. and Wharton was in my backyard in Pennsylvania. And so after practice and in through the summer, I would be at Wharton taking classes. And one professor, Peter Lenneman, became a really close friend and mentor, and was highly instrumental in my journey post-athletics of like trying to navigate, you know, what do I do after the football skier guy, you know, doesn't catch the balls or do the backflips anymore. And the first thing that I started was Wish of a Lifetime. And it's a 501c3 nonprofit. And we grant wishes to the oldest generation, 80, 90, and 100-year-old people. And really what drove me to that cause is my grandfather flew 17 missions over Berlin in World War II, helping to liberate concentration camps all throughout Poland and Germany. And he was also, before my dad took over, my very first ski coach. And he would pin a Superman cape on my back, and he would take these little miniature-sized candy bars, and we'd get off the lift, and he'd throw them as far as he could. He said, if you figure out how to ski down to get the candy bar, you can eat it. So, like, needless to say, I loved skiing at a young age through my grandfather's creativity. And, you know, I had traveled the world and I'd seen different cultures, especially ones like in the South Pacific, like Japan, how folks treat the oldest in their society with an amazing sense of reverence. I was 16 on a public bus in Tokyo, really crowded bus, and I saw this elderly woman start walking onto the bus, and I watched everybody get out of their seat, help her onto the bus, and then they bowed to her. And I was 16. I mean, that, talk about a foreign cultural experience. I had no idea what was going on. And I just came to learn that that's pretty normal. And so Wish of a Lifetime was really created to build a cultural bridge across those kind of different cultures and into ours, and expose not only the wish recipient to live out their crazy, wild dream, whatever that might be, but as a reminder to all of us that these people are treasures and we should help and support and thank and make them know that their dreams are so important. This is Nancy Tarpin, our very first wish recipient. I met Nancy. She didn't know who I was. She just knew that I wanted to talk to her. And I said, Nancy, if there's, you know, one thing in your life, anything you could do, what would it be? And she said, well, my daughter Lucille was diagnosed with terminal ovarian cancer about a decade ago. She lives in Claypool, Arizona. And we talk on the phone every day, but her condition's getting worse and worse, and it tears my heart out to know that I'm going to lose my daughter without being able to say goodbye. Now imagine that reality. A lot of folks here have kids. Like, I could not comprehend that. I had just, you know, gotten back from the Pittsburgh Steelers training camp or whatever, traveling the world. Like, you know that saying, you don't know what someone's going through until you take a walk in their shoes. That was like my dose of reality. And so Nancy and I boarded a plane. This is a photo outside of baggage claim. We went to Claypool, Arizona. I dropped her off. I met Lucille. I picked her up 3 days later, and I picked up a completely different, changed human being. The energy that she exuded by just that simple experience of spending 3 days with her daughter was one of which that I had never experienced in sport, ever winning a football game or whatever. And it was that point where I knew, wish of a lifetime, we were going to do some really cool things. I want to share a couple more wishes with you. Most common wish that we get is probably not surprising, but it's the reconnection of people in our lives. And Ruby, Ruth, and Rose are three sisters that grew up on a farm in Kansas, and they hadn't seen each other for over 15 years. This is a photo of them growing up on the farm. But what was unique about this wish request is they wrote in, the youngest, Ruby, on the left wrote in, my wish of a lifetime is to see my two sisters. We haven't seen each other for 15 years. Well, the youngest was 104. And the oldest, bottom left, was 112. So three centenarian sisters who hadn't seen each other in 15 years flew two of them to Connecticut where the oldest lived. And to be a fly on the wall in that experience was something I could never describe. I mean, they literally grew up in a world that is so vastly different than the world that we're living in today. It was absolutely striking. And Olive challenged us because at 96, 97, she said, my wish of a lifetime is to see the future. Okay. Fortunately, she gave some context. She wanted to go to Google and see all the crazy and innovative things that Google is working on.
97-year-old Olive Horrell grew up in a time long before computers and smartphones.
We had no electricity, no radio, horse and buggy.
But on this day, she wasn't only riding in a car, but a Google self-driving car.
This is pretty amazing, everybody.
And that wasn't the only stop on her Google VIP tour. There was drawing with the Google Doodle team, trying out technology that helps people with tremors.
Wonderful thing to have.
And an introduction to virtual reality.
You mean all the way around? Where are these coming from?
While the day was full of firsts for the great-grandmother, Olive is far from a tech novice. She reads on a Kindle, uses her laptop to email, and once called Apple tech support when she wanted to fix her computer. But she wanted to know more about how technology worked, including something many people wonder. What exactly is the cloud?
The cloud is basically a computer that I don't have to hold in my hands, but I have access to.
So through a partnership with her assisted living community, Brookdale, and the organization Wish of a Lifetime, Olive wasn't just searching Google, she was touring it.
Make a wish and have it come true.
Her experience was once in a lifetime. In Mountain View, Lexi Savines, CNET.com for CBS News.
Amazing human being. I mean, to be intellectually curious at 97, I think we can all agree that's a gift. She really is a gift. Today, Wish of a Lifetime, we're granting over one wish per day, and we're in Canada as well, so we're granting wishes in the U.S. and Canada. It's been an amazing 10-year journey that we've been on. One of the things I love to do when I get to meet our wish recipients is ask them, what should we be thinking about? Like, you've seen this movie. You've been on this ride. Like, what are some regrets or some opportunities? Like, how should we be thinking about, you know, this journey that we're on, and what are some things that you would tell us? And I've kind of, you know, created four key categories of feedback that I most commonly hear. And the first one is this notion is live life with a strong bias towards yes. And I think the context behind that is we will very likely regret the things we didn't do, not necessarily the things that we did do, even if the things that we did do seem like mistakes at the time. The other one is have no doubt that your world, your life, is unfolding as it should. We put so much friction into the world with whatever circumstance that we're in if we don't like it, which can be very healthy. That's how we get out of those situations. But at times, we're way too hard on ourselves. And we just don't allow things to flow through, and it's a very common area of feedback that I hear. The other one is this idea of carve your own path. I think that's really symbolic of that generation. I think they were born into a world that was very clearly defined for them, not a lot of opportunities. Today, we are living in a world with an amazing amount of opportunities for what we can do professionally. And the final one, it's the obvious one. We only get one body. We should take care of it. But I will say, for the folks who are in the 90s and hundreds, the one common theme that the folks who are still with it and sharp and articulate and excited about their life, it's not diet, but it is exercise. It's like, never stop moving. Like, I hear that all the time. Take the walk, read the book, stay engaged, even when life tells you to turn off. It wasn't long after I started Wish of a Lifetime that I realized that having a nonprofit's not a great way to make a living. So if I wanted to do anything after sports, I would have to kind of harness in the stuff that I learned and was exposed to at Wharton. So started Integrate in May of 2010. This was our humble beginnings, like so many other startups. We painted that concrete floor. It was in an unfinished house. Didn't know at the time, but hired five salespeople to work down there. But what we didn't know at the time was there was no cell phone service down there. So you had to go outside to take the calls. Meanwhile, this is Denver, Colorado. You know, it's kind of cold in the winter like here in Chicago. But they made it work. And today our headquarters looks a little bit different. This is our headquarters downtown Phoenix. So if you fly into Phoenix Airport, you'll see us right behind the Wells Fargo building. We're on G2. We're an excited partner of G2. We hear G2 coming up more and more in our sales cycle in a positive way. So we're excited for your guys' growth and to be part of that and to continue to invest in that. The short 20 seconds on Integrate is we ask ourselves the question, why aren't more people in marketing focused on a successful prospecting journey? Like, yes, once they become a customer, we have a great infrastructure for customer success, right? We put a lot of focus and energy into customer success, but I mean, we're all prospects. I think very few of us have ever had an amazing prospect journey. And I think what we're learning and realizing is the way that we can get there is by orchestrating marketing in a way that traditionally couldn't have been done before across the top of the funnel, hence our name Integrate. So we're connecting in various areas and delivering this like big idea to marketers to think more about every touch point that a prospect has with our brand can be successful, whether they buy or whether they don't. We believe that is the future. I want to share, in closing, I only have about, I think, two more slides or three. But I really have captured these five cultural pillars from all the various journeys that I've been able to see, whether it be sports or football, or now being the CEO at Integrate for almost a decade, and some of the Integrate team is here and helped create some of these. But I'll go through them very briefly. Centering everything around the customer, I think, is really strong. Like, when everything, like the nucleus of whatever we do centers from the customer, I think amazing things can happen. And I think above that, I would first call out performance. It's like the Reed Hastings philosophy of culture, if anybody's read that Netflix culture deck, which is amazing. But if we go to work every day and we know that our number one job is to add value, we really reduce the likelihood of organizational politics. The green one's the obvious, right? Innovation. But innovation's really easy when you're young, because you don't know what the company's gonna be, right? You're throwing everything against the wall and like, what's gonna stick, what's not. And then you get to a certain size and Integrate, we're almost 300 people. Across six offices, super spread out, super users on Zoom. But how do you keep innovating? How do you keep taking risks, even when you're at great scale? So it's a constant reminder. Happiness, it was cool to watch Eric before, because I think what Zoom built was a big reason why happiness lives inside of our cultural pillars. And it's not just happiness internally, but it's happiness to our customers. The one note I would say about happiness, because I heard Eric say, like, ask yourself every day if you're happy. That is a losing proposition. Happiness is fleeting. Happiness comes and goes for every single person. I'm working on a documentary right now with Michael Phelps. Right? Michael Phelps has won more Olympic gold medals than anybody else. He's got lots of money. He's got lots of fame. He has gone through a serious depression in his life. So happiness, if it doesn't come from money, doesn't come from success, it's fleeting. So I think allowing ourselves to be not okay is as important as asking ourselves, are we happy every day? Trust, if you don't have trust, we're going to have a really difficult culture. And then being radically candid with each other, like sharing real feedback even when it's difficult. So in summary, as I reflect back on, you know, kind of my journey, I've had so many more setbacks and quote-unquote failures than successes, but I've just had one enough success in each area to climb that mountain. And I've always been interested in this subject, like why can failure or setbacks help sharpen the sword, help recalibrate the compass towards success? And I got an opportunity to write a book about it, and I really studied and I spent time with folks who have done it way better than I have. And this book was really written out of this strong desire to study the topic. And I'm happy to say that inside the book is a framework from other folks, including anecdotes from my life, on how we can do that better, how we can strengthen our sword better in those inevitable moments of failure. It's on Amazon if you want to check it out. And finally, I want to share with you my favorite slide. If anyone were to ask, like, show life in one slide, it would be this. Like, right? We and all of us can relate to this because professionally we live in a world where it's got to be up and to the right. It's got to be growth. It's got to be growth at all costs. It's got to be. And then think about socially. Oh my goodness! Like, think about the challenges that young kids have in today's world that we didn't. We all have this social measuring stick now, called social media, where everybody can measure their life next to somebody else's. But what's the flaw in that? We're only sharing our best moments, right? Like, everyone's just sharing the best, like, highlight reel. Nobody's like, oh, failed at work today. Can't wait to get back there tomorrow. You know, like, we don't share those things. And so next time you find yourself maybe rock bottom, or maybe with a daily challenge. One, set an expiration date. Maybe it's a minute, maybe it's 10, maybe it's 48 hours, maybe it's 6 months. But set an intention that you're gonna move past that at a certain period of time, and don't personalize it. We all go through those moments. We've all been there. You'll be stronger for it. Sharpen your sword and go attack whatever's next. Pleasure to be here. Thanks so much for having me.